Yes.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
How does it feel to be here, you know, launching your own book that you wrote?
I don't know. It's a new feeling. I keep saying, oh, I have to go to the film festival. And I don't realize it's a literary It's a literary festival. I say, oh, I hope the viewers will enjoy it. And they're actually readers, not viewers. So I'm getting used to a new language now. But it's very exciting. Right. And thank you all for coming and for being here today. It's a special moment. My whole family is here. Thank you for being here. This book wouldn't have existed if it wasn't for the more famous members of my family.
Could we please have a round of applause for Soha Ali Khan, ladies and gentlemen? All right, so I'm going to just ask you a couple of questions just to get to know, you know, a little bit more about how you feel about your book. The first question I want to ask, why did you decide to write this book at this very young age?
Thank you.
She's very young, guys.
Moderately young, yes.
Moderately young. Everything she has is moderate.
I actually didn't decide to write the book at all. I have to say that Penguin, my publishers, came to me and they said, would you be interested? We know you like to read a lot. And I didn't quite make the connection because I was like, well, yes, I do like reading, but that doesn't mean that I know how to write a book. And they said, oh, well, you've been to Oxford, so presumably you can string a sentence together. and I said, yes, I have written a couple of columns before and essays, but to write 40, 50,000 words is a huge task. And what I said was, let me write an introduction. I would like it to be nonfiction because I honestly don't have the imagination for creative fiction. And I felt that maybe there's certain things about my life that I could draw from that might be humorous. You know, it's interesting to be me, to belong to this family, to be an actor, to be at this stage of my life, to have had the experiences that I've had, be it education or travel or love or all of that. And maybe I can put something together. So I did, and I shared it with some members of my family and some friends. And if you know my family and those friends are not the kind of people who go, wah, wah, beta. You know, there's lots of critical, usually constructive feedback. And it was more or less encouraging, and that's why I decided to go ahead and write the rest of the book. 39,000 words, yeah.
39,000 words. That's great. So I read the book. I did. Over the last 2 days, I've been reading this book, and I love it. It's an easy read. It's full of interesting anecdotes. I particularly love the beginning bits about your lineage and the stories about your great-great-grandparents and your grandparents. And it was just really relatable for me, at least. You know, as a woman, a single woman living in the city, it was just, not that you're single, but I'm just saying, like, there were moments in the book where you were single, and I was like, oh, I can relate to that. Yes. So I found it very relatable. And I actually found the title very funny, which is why I actually, when the Penguin came up to me and said, would you like to host this, they told me the title, and I was like, definitely, this looks like a really funny book. And I love that it's slightly self-deprecating. Why did you choose to...
You know, actually, I thought of the title first, and then I had to put the book together to reflect the title. And I like the way certain words sound, and I like the word peril. I don't know why, but I like the sound of it. And it can be somewhat perilous, being me. It's a place where sometimes you're struggling to exist, especially as an actor in a city like this, and in a family like that belong to a family like this. Are you crying because of the wind? Are you feeling
such an
emotional moment? Yes. So I just thought, and I thought moderately famous is also interesting. It came to me because there's a certain national newspaper that, you know, on the cover of their paper every month, they have an index of fame, which always amused me. And it's from 1 to 50. And actresses are rated from 1 to 50 on how popular they are that month.
Just actresses?
Actors as well.
Okay.
And female actors, like myself. And I've seen, I think my personal best was 15. I don't know what I did that month.
Well, and that deserves a round of applause. Yeah, 15 on that index.
And then, of course, I was 49, hanging on for a while. And then I was kicked out as well for a few months. And I was like, oh, no, I'm not there at all. And I thought it would be, it's funny to laugh at yourself before anyone else does. Yeah. You must laugh at yourself first. And then the book just fell into place after that.
No, it's great. I mean, there were so many moments in the book where you were making fun of yourself. And I like thoroughly enjoyed that. And I was like, well done. Like, it takes a lot of guts to it takes a lot of guts to write a book where you were just so open about your life. Like, you know, there was a lot of stuff in that book where I was like, wow, I can't believe she wrote this. And especially someone
what parts? You know, I think that's what
happens. You're not going to let them decide. Read the book.
The point is I do a lot of my writing at night, at 2 in the morning when the whole house goes to sleep. And that's when you're alone, in bed with your laptop and you often write things forgetting that other people are going to read it.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, you know, you forget about it and you move on and you hand it in to your publishers and then the book is out.
No, but I mean, nothing serious, guys. We'll read the book and find.
Also told me that they, only after reading the book, have they got to know me in a way that they haven't, even having known me for 10 years. So I do think that I have given off myself. I'm generally quite a reserved person. You can chat with me for 4 hours and then go away and still not know much about me. And so I made an effort, and I do have to say, my mother also, who's sitting here in the front row, did say that you should be honest, and you should, I think as readers, they want to learn a little bit about you. If they're being kind enough to buy your book, you must tell them a few things, but also strike the right balance between giving away too much, and also when it comes to humor like this, you shouldn't be too hard on yourself and too self-deprecating, but also you should be able to laugh at yourself in the right spirit.
Right. I should take those tips for my stand-up comedy. I'm going to ask you one last question before we call on your family. What do you want people to take away from this book? Like, you told us why you wrote it. What do you want people, like, when they go away, what do you want them to kind of
I want them to take away the book when they go. That's it. You know.
Just take away the book.
I get 10%.
Great. That's awesome. Ladies and gentlemen, Soha Ali Khan, please give a round of applause.
Thank you.
All right, sorry. So I'm gonna be calling up family members of yours, and they are gonna share with us some anecdotes, and also read from your book some excerpts from your book. You excited? You have no idea what they're gonna say, right?
I have no idea.
Lovely. So on stage first, could we please have your husband, Kunal Ghemu, ladies and gentlemen. Woo!
Good evening, everybody. I had nothing to do with the book. But my face is on it, so good.
Hi, Kunal.
Hi.
You didn't. The whole last page is dedicated to thanking you, by the
way.
You had a lot to do with this book, apparently.
That's the consolation prize for sitting up at night and hearing it again and again. No, but I'm very happy she wrote this book because, like she mentioned earlier, there was. So when she said that, I've been asked to write a book, and I was like, great, because. The first thing I knew, it wasn't going to be fiction because she can't string a story together. I mean, she's very good at words, but she lacks a little bit of imagination. So I was like, oh, are you writing fiction? So she's like, no. And I said, okay, so try it. You might enjoy it. And she wrote a chapter, and when I read it, for selfish reasons, I was like, I don't know this about her. So I was like, why didn't you write this book? Because I'm kind of learning so many things about you that you didn't know. Because earlier, she would always be like, it wasn't interesting, I don't remember. But now she was forced to do that. So I was very intrigued and interested to know. But then later I found out that there were rewrites. And I had to read those again. And it's amazing that she was also pregnant during when she was writing this book.
Yeah.
So she was also a bit hormonal, so I couldn't refuse to ask one too many times. And I've seen that over the years, in every relationship, and today I know this because I just realized that last week, there's this amazing statement that is used, do you want to do this? So it would start in the earlier phase of the relationship, like, do you want to pick me up and take me out for dinner? I was like, yes. And then came to, do you want to turn the lights off? And I'm like, do I want to? Okay. Now, recently, it's like, do you want to check on the baby? Do you want to do this? So you realize that do is just there. It's actually you want to. You just don't know it. So yes, do I want to talk about this? Yes.
Yes.
I really do. But it's...
Yeah, ladies and gentlemen, please look out for Kunal Ghemu's next book, The Perils of Being Married to Soha Ali Khan.
I think it'll be called Do You Want To?
Do You Want To?
! But no, so...
Yeah.
Okay, I don't even know if there was a question, but I'm
No,
sorry.
No,
sorry.
No, it was.
Life, as John Lennon famously sang in Beautiful Boy, is what happens when you're busy making other plans. It was the spring of 2008, and I had signed a film called Hum Tere Jaoge, opposite a young, talented actor. Yes, we take a pause now. We relish it, and now move on. The director wanted us to meet at Taj Lands End in Bandra for a script reading. They were already seated at the table at the coffee shop when I got there. The director and a well-built boy in straight-fit jeans, half-sleeved white shirt, and barely contained his straining biceps.
You're making this up!
Which have disappeared. boots and a belt with a horseshoe bronze buckle. His eyes were hidden behind heavily tinted sunglasses, and his hair was a dark mop of unruly curls. My first impression, this boy must live in the gym. What will we talk about apart from protein shakes? It was an opinion that survived well into the shooting of the film, because over the course of Mumbai's schedule, Kunal must have spoken a total of 15 words to me. Far from exchanging numbers, we seemed to steer clear of each other, except for when we were in position for a two-shot and there was an issue with the lighting or camera. Below are the longest conversations during these 2 months. Conversation one, me. That's all. So, what do you like to do in your spare time? Kunal, not a lot. I like to watch films. Me. Do you go out a lot? Kunal. No, I like to watch films a lot. End of conversation. Second conversation took place when she was writing something on her laptop. Kunal, what are you writing? Me. An article for my college, the Oxford Magazine. End of conversation. So that was the first 2 months.
And now we're here.
There's more, but you love my
book. Were you shy?
I was just nervous.
Aww.
I was nervous because of my reasons, actually. She's very beautiful. She still is.
Yes.
And I remember this conversation. She is, yeah. But I'm saying that time I was kind of hit with that. That the sunglasses hit it really well, and the curly hair helped. But I was like, I don't know what to say to her. And then when she said she was writing for the Oxford Journal, I was like, the only Oxford thing I've read is a dictionary. I don't even know, and I'm not very good at that either. So, and there were so many times that, so I fight in Hindi, she fights in English. And there are times that words are being said to me that I have no idea what they mean. So I'm like, I'm really offended, not just because you were wrong, because I don't even know what you're saying to me. So I have to remember this now, go Google, what does this mean? Oh shit, I can't believe you said this to me. So it's really improved my vocabulary actually.
Kareena told you guys she was writing a book. What did you guys think? Did she come tell you guys she's writing a book, or did you just find out today?
I think I'd like my other sister, who I'd like to introduce you to, Saba.
Yeah, Saba. How did you?
Google a lot of words and so on. But she is, mashallah, very. She writes really well. She speaks really well. So I don't think I would be surprised.
अरे मोबाइल वाले को बोल नीचे करने भाई इतना ऊपर.
मोबाइल. मोबाइल.
Saif, what about you? Did she, when she came up to you, were you? I mean, were you surprised or were you like, yes, that's...
Well, actually, I had the pleasure of reading some of the early proofs.
Like
and
enough.
I thought they were hysterical, really, really funny. And really well written and well balanced and, you know, with a funny start and a great, great sense of humor. So I'm very excited about this. I think it was a really good read.
But I'm glad you sound really proud. Do you have any anecdotes you want to share or any
about
words?
Soha?
Yeah, something from that we might not find in the book.
Well, I mean, you know, first of all, I'd like to congratulate her. I think this is a great occasion. I think she's done really well with this thing. Sohabia, you know, obviously went to a wonderful university. I went to two wonderful universities. Went to Oxford as well as London School of Economics. Highly qualified and was working in Citibank and all set to do that. And then she came to stay with me for a summer and quit her job and joined movies. And I'm not sure how my parents felt about that, but she's of course has her mother's blood and genes as well. And was drawn to this profession. There was a time, you know, that she's misleading. She seems quiet and very, very sweet and polite, which she is. And she's a source of strength for us, and I'm very happy she lives in the same city as I do. But she had gone out to dinner once. I want to tell the story. It was before she met Kemu here. I hope he doesn't mind me saying this, but it was kind of a date. He was a really wealthy guy, and he was a big industrialist, and everyone was kind of wondering how this was going to work out. And he was talking to Soha, and Soha was really bored. I don't know if she was already seeing Kunal, and no, in the sense that, you know, just went out to be polite. Anyway, she's out at this dinner, and her friend messages her and says, you know, how's it going? And she says, she replies, hey, you know, he's really boring. And she sends the message to the guy she's having dinner with. And now this is Soha. She doesn't skip a beat. She says to the guy, excuse me, can I borrow your phone, please? Takes it, deletes it, gives it back, and carries on.
Well,
my sister. Yeah. So, you know, I've known her for a very long time. I'm very happy she's on my side. And look, this is a very, I mean, you want me to read some of this book?
Yes.
Out?
Yeah. If you, there's a chapter about you guys.
क्या चला भाई अरे बाइक के इधर से ही बाइक होएगा खड़े खड़े
या व्हाट
इज अरे इधर से ही चलेगा इधर आए ना एक्टर
इट्स अ चैप्टर कॉल्ड सेफीना ओह इट्स अ चैप्टर कॉल्ड ऑल रोड्स लीड टू सेफीना
राइट I was still lying in bed, scrolling through my Twitter feed, sipping coffee, more asleep than awake, when I saw the headline. Soha reveals major secret about Kareena Kapoor's pregnancy. What? When? Where? Who? I couldn't answer any of the four basic questions journalists are taught to ask, but I was already panicking. The coffee had turned to mud in my mouth, and I was finding it difficult to breathe. I'm usually so careful. I never say anything about Amma, Bhai, and Kareena, and especially nothing about the baby. Had I inadvertently let something slip? I sat up and scanned the rest of the article, and the more I read, the more I relaxed. The major secret was that Bhai and Kareena, or Saifina, as they are together referred to, were not planning to have their child in London, as far as I knew. I remembered the interview. I remember answering the obligatory question about how I was feeling about becoming a bua again, dismissing the one about what preparations we were making, expressing vitriol about the one whether I wanted a girl or a boy for them. Will they have the baby in London? The question had come out of the blue, and I was bemused. Why would they want to have the baby in London? There was some furious scribbling and a furtive exchange of glances, and I hastily added, I have no idea what they're planning, and as far as I know, they aren't planning to have the baby in London. I ended with my most convincing, but what would I know, shrug. So the fact that the baby would not be born in London, or Bolivia, or Zimbabwe, or Mars for that matter, was major news. Any tiny detail or non-detail is major news. And some journalists will come up with the most ingenious ways to uncover these tidbits, as illustrated below by the line of questioning I am often subjected to. Whilst premiering the first episode of The Great Indian Home Makeover, a televised show on interior redecorating that I host. Question. Tell us about the show. Answer. It's a home makeover show where we surprise the homeowner and make over one room in the space of 48 hours. Question. Speaking of redecorating, how are you doing the baby's room in Safina's house? Whilst at a press conference for Balmain watches. Question. Tell us what you like about Balmain watches. Answer. They are stylish, elegant, and feminine. A woman's watch is more than a timepiece. It's a piece of jewelry, a style accessory. Question. Speaking of time, it's a happy time in the family with the baby coming. When is it due? Whilst at a store inauguration for a jewelry brand. Question. What is your favorite piece of jewelry? Answer. My engagement ring, for obvious reasons. Question. Speaking of rings, you will be ringing in the new year with a new family member. How will all of you spend New Year's Eve? Whilst promoting the film 31st October. Question. Tell us about the film and your role in it. Answer. It's a real life story about 1984 anti-Sikh riots, and I play a Sardarni. I have three children in the film. Question. Speaking of children. Okay, this one I can forgive. Whilst at a feminine diva style contest. Question. What does style mean to you? Answer. Wearing your personality on your sleeve. being comfortable, confident, and carrying yourself in a way that makes you stand out. Question. Speaking of standing out, isn't Kareena setting new fashion trends with her baby bump? During a lifestyle interview. Question. Where do you see yourself 5 years from now? Answer. I don't plan that much ahead. I try not to live in the past or plan for the future. I live in the present. Question. Speaking of presents, what are you going to give the baby? Have you decided? During a press conference to announce Kunal and my production company, Renegade Films. Question. Why did you choose the name? Why did you choose your name? Choose to name your company Renegade Films? Answer. Well, Renegade means rebel. We like that it stands for going against the grain, doing things differently. Question. Speaking of names, is it true they're naming their baby Saifina? You get the drift. I calculated that the damage done in this instance was minimal, so I tossed my phone aside, took another sip of my coffee, and turned to the less alarming headlines of the national press. Very nice, sir.
Such a great chapter. Thank you so much, Saif. Kareena, would you like to say a few words or anything you want to add to that chapter?
Well, I think I'm rarely intimidated by anyone, as I'm sure most of the media knows. But if there's one person in the family that I'm completely in awe of, I think it's Soha.
Thank you so much.
I mean, obviously, just a little nervous taking a cue from Kunal. Obviously, being that when I'm at dinner with Saif and Soha, I'm like, oh my God, I'm never going to understand this conversation. If Kunal can't, there's no way that I can. So Soha's always been so polite. She's always been like, oh, yeah, hi, what's up? So yeah, okay, did you buy anything? So what's the gossip? So I'm like, oh God, I feel so small and lame. Is this what it's really going to be? And then I was like, but it's okay. But I think we found our way. And if there's anyone in the family that I think any of us turn to when Amma's all worked up and fired up, then there's just one person that can control the situation, then that's Soha. So, I mean, I truly, truly believe that she is the torchbearer of this family. And this title it doesn't do justice, because famous or not famous, she is the grounding in which all of us stand on. And I've truly seen that the way she has compassionately and with just as a breaking heart when her father was passing away. I've never seen any daughter. I'm a daughter. But I don't know if I could have done the way she looked after him. And that, in my eyes, to me, is a solid woman. So here's to you, Soha. And I'm sure Abba's listening to all of this. Yes, so. Fantastic. Let's hear it for none other than the brightest in the family, Soha Ali Khan.
Thank you so much. Okay, that was really sweet. And it's just so nice. You guys clearly seem really, really proud of Soha. And yeah. And also, just so you guys know, like, the book is an easy read. I know people talk about how she uses big words. I understood everything in the book. So don't be scared. Don't let them scare you off. Oh, that's lovely. I'd like to now call your mom on stage. Would you like tissue, sir? Are you okay?
Fine, thank you.
Really hard wind. Like. Could we please have Sharmila Ji on stage? Give a round of applause, ladies and gentlemen.